Hello everyone, and welcome to today's webinar, Dental Management of Female Patients with Bleeding Disorders, hosted by the Foundation for Women and Girls with Blood Disorders. Next slide. My name is Dr. Evelyn Lockhart, and I am the Clinical Director of Transfusion Medicine for Duke University Health System and today's Activity Medical Director and Moderator. Today's presenters are Dr. Andrew Brewer and Ms. Karen Ridley. We are glad to have this audience here. We would like to remind everyone of the mission for Foundation for Women and Girls with Blood Disorders, in that we seek to ensure all women and adolescent girls with blood disorders are correctly diagnosed and optimally treated and managed at every life stage. Next slide. I'd also like to acknowledge the FWGBD board members, Andrew James, Barbara Conkle, Leslie Graham, Roshni Kulkarni, Jennifer Dietrich, Kenneth Mann, Kim Smith-Whitley, and myself for contributing today's activity. Next slide. Today's presenters are Dr. Andrew Brewer, Associate Specialist in Oral Surgery at Southern General Hospital in Glasgow, Scotland, and Clinical Lecturer at the University of Glasgow, and Karen Ridley, Dental Hygienist for the University of Michigan Hemophilia and Coagulation Disorders Program, as well as for the Michigan State University Bleeding and Clotting Disorders Program, and an assistant professor in the Division of Dental Hygiene at the University of Michigan School of Dentistry in Ann Arbor, Michigan. Next slide. To ensure the best sound quality during the webinar today, all attendees will be muted. However, all attendees will have the opportunity to participate in a question and answer session with the instructors at the end of the webinar. You can submit your questions during or after the webinar via the chat box in your GoToWebinar control panel on the right-hand side of your screen, as illustrated in this slide. We gladly welcome your input. Our first speaker today will be Dr. Andrew Brewer. Dr. Brewer?
Thank you. I have no disclosures of interest for this presentation. Dental treatment has been a problem, and Mark Skinner, who was the president of the World Federation of Hemophilia until recently, mentioned in his presidential address in Istanbul that he wished treatment for all. At that meeting, the dental committee felt that we should adopt a similar slogan, and our slogan is dental treatment for all. Patients with bleeding disorders have in the past not always received the best level of care, and in many places and many countries in the world, care has only been available at hemophilia treatment centers. This is not ideal, as it prevents many patients from receiving good treatment. We now know that many treatment plans can be carried out by local general practitioners in their own offices. Our major principles are shown in this slide, that patients with bleeding disorders should receive the same level of care as any other patient. Critically, care should be available locally. That means they should be able to go to the same dentist as colleagues that they work with, friends at home. The treatment plan may need to be modified slightly as a result of the bleeding disorder, and we'll talk about this later. And through the Hemophilia Treatment Center, specialist dental services should also be available by referral. So we have the next slide. Hemophilia treatment is coordinated through the Hemophilia Treatment Centers, and this is a comprehensive care team policy. And it requires a broad range of healthcare providers and support workers who work together as a team. This gives improved outcomes in mobility and mortality within this centre. The groups that are involved are the haematologist, physical therapists, nurses, the whole dental team, psychosocial workers, laboratory technicians, and also the orthopaedic teams. In the dental surgery, the first thing we have to do is the dental history and examination. And it is critical that we both find out why the patient has come. Many will only come to the dental surgery when they've got problems, but others will come for routine checkups. Patients with bleeding disorders have the same problems as all patients. That is pain, swelling, broken teeth, difficulty chewing or swallowing, recurrent ulcers, dental caries, periodontal disease, impacted teeth. And it's very easy to forget about these when you see on the medical history form some form of bleeding disorder. Plaque is a major problem in dentistry throughout the world. And the main plaque retention factors are shown here: calculus, poorly formed restorations, caries, partial dentures, orthodontic appliances, and malpositioned teeth. And in some elderly patients, as shown here, you get a buildup of calculus and plaque because of inability to clean teeth properly. Again, this patient was one of mine who attended with a large plaque of calculus around her lower teeth. Once removed, these teeth, believe it or not, were still sound and useful. We have to remember that this was carried out even though this patient did have a bleeding disorder. The principles of treatment planning are the same as for anybody. A recent publication by Anderson et al. In the British Dental Journal describes the plans which have been put in place in the United Kingdom. The majority of this work is easily translated over to other countries in the world. And this describes very thoroughly the treatment, the methods of carrying out treatment, the problems, and other details. I will pick out some of the important points in this talk. The World Federation of Haemophilia have also produced two guidelines on the treatment of patients with bleeding disorders. These were particularly aimed at the male patients, but can equally be used for women and girls with blood disorders. In dentistry, we try to divide the patients into two groups. Sorry, I've lost control at the moment. Can I have the next slide? My machine doesn't seem to be working. We try to divide the patients into two groups, both the severe and the moderate groups, and the milds and the carriers. The severe and moderate groups tend to be those that are diagnosed by the haemophilia treatment centres as those with lower factor levels. And the mild patients and the carriers are obviously the less severe patients. The aim of our policy is that patients with severe and moderate forms of the disease, and this applies to all bleeding disorders, should have their treatment either in a hospital setting or by special arrangement with the haemophilia unit, as these patients often need significant input from the haemophilia treatment centre at the time of treatment. Edentulous patients, however, can have prosthodontics carried out by any dental surgeon. The mild patients and the carriers, we try to treat as many of these patients or arrange for their patient to be treated by their dental practitioner. This again means they can get the treatment locally. The patient should be reviewed by a hospital service at some point and at regular intervals, because some of these patients are not very good at attending the dentist for treatment, even though they promise to go. Special care is particularly required for the administration of local anesthesia, extractions, minor oral surgery, periodontal surgery, and biopsies. This means that the majority of restorative treatment can be carried out without the need for any particular product. Local anesthetic is a matter which we'll discuss later, and obviously is used regularly. Extractions should be really seen as a failure of treatment, except in the case of orthodontic extractions and the removal of impacted teeth. Two major interactions are important to us. One is the use of aspirin as an analgesic, and this must be avoided. Similarly, non-steroidal analgesia must be avoided, as both of these drugs affect the platelets. And in patients who already have a bleeding disorder, to then have poorly functioning platelets causes a huge problem and bleeding which can be extremely difficult to control. Dental treatment that I mentioned before may require cover to prevent bleeding. Its use has to be discussed with the Haemophilia Center, and we ask them to organize and administer any cover that is required. You may be surprised as you get into treating this group of patients that there are some patients that the Haemophilia Treatment Center will advise you to give no cover. However, others that you would expect not to have cover will require it. So it is important every case is discussed individually. When carrying out dental treatment of any sort, it is vital that accidental damage to the oral mucosa is prevented. Now, this can be in doing fairly simple things which are carried out on a daily basis in the dental office. This is by careful use of saliva ejectors, carefully removing impressions, ensuring the impression tray does not damage the mucosa when you put it in, careful placement of radiographic films, particularly when we're taking them in the lower jaw, and protection of soft tissues in restorative treatment by using a rubber dam or applying yellow soft paraffin or similar products to try and prevent local damage. Removable prosthodontics. These are very good in patients with bleeding disorders, but they have to be comfortable. And in partial dentures, or partial prosthodontics, it is important that the periodontal health of the remaining teeth is maintained throughout. The next two slides show some of the problems associated with denture wearing. The one on the left shows denture-induced hyperplasia, and the one on the right is just gingival irritation from wearing a denture for too long every day and not cleaning it properly. And this next slide shows a patient who came in with complaining that their upper denture didn't fit, and this leaf fibroma had developed slowly over a number of years, causing the denture not to fit. These simple things have to be remembered when we're looking at patients with haemophilia and other bleeding disorders. Routine restorative treatment can be undertaken, providing care is taken to protect the mucosa. The area of concern is with the use of matrix band, wooden wedges, and other gingival retraction. Usually, local measures will control the bleeding in these positions. In restorative treatment, caries is obviously the major culprit that we have to deal with. And teeth with new caries lesions can be restored using an appropriate technique. And I'm listing several here: amalgam, tooth-colored restorations. More severe lesions may need root canal therapy and even the placement of a crown. All of these techniques are applicable and used in patients with bleeding disorders. With previously restored teeth, during the examination, it's important to check for edges and ledges around the restorations, because this is an area where you can get caries which occurs and not noticed, you can get plaque developing, and it will also prevent the local gingiva being healthy. The restorations should be replaced as required, and crowns and bridges may be replaced, may be placed as appropriate, using the same principles for about placement as for any other patient. Endodontic treatment is classed as a low-risk procedure for patients with bleeding disorders. This is because we are working within the tooth and the risk of bleeding is minimal. If pulpectomy is indicated, the possibility of the tooth requiring conventional endodontic treatment must also be considered. It's important that the procedure is carried out carefully and that the working length of the canal is calculated to ensure the instruments do not pass through the apex of the root canal. With this group of patients, we would also not advise using a single visit technique for doing endodontics because there may be a very minimal late bleed which could be quite painful. The use of antifibrinolytic agents is important and will help us with local measures. One of the common ones used is tranexamic acid. And a lot of the dental literature talks about this drug rather than Amicar. An antifibrinolytic agent is used to prevent excess bleeding. And common examples of its use are menstrual bleeding, obstetrics, other bleeding disorders, cardiac surgery, orthopedic surgery. It's available both as a tablet of 500 milligrams and as an intravenous preparation. A tissue concentration of 10 micrograms per mil will reduce plasminogen activator levels by 80%. This level of inhibition is sufficient to cause sufficient reduction of the fibrinolytic activity in tissues to aid in stopping bleeding. Activators of fibrinolysis have been demonstrated in the saliva and the alveolus after dental extraction. Forbes et al. Demonstrated a significant reduction of post-extraction bleeding if oral tranexamic acid bleed was taken, and they started the drug the day before treatment. Sindet, Peterson and Stenberg used the mouthwash 4 times a day and again showed a reduction in post-extraction bleeding. They used a topical application which again showed the same bleeding lack. However, there are problems associated with the mouthwash to do with cost and also the taste of it, which a lot of patients don't like. Extractions and surgery are obviously one of the major areas of concern. And a simple way of looking at it is, once the tooth has been decided that the tooth needs to be removed, the patient will require appropriate cover from the hemophilia center. The treatment should be carried out as atraumatically as possible. Antibiotics should only be used when you would use them anyway. They shouldn't be used just because the patient has got hemophilia. With patients with bleeding disorders, it's sensible to observe the patient following the extraction. And we would advise that the patient with a mild to moderate form of the disease is supervised and monitored for 2 to 3 hours, where with the more severe forms you may want to keep them in hospital overnight. The patients should also get comprehensive post-operative instructions which will tell them what to do in the event of a bleed. Now this may be for the more severe patients to take extra factor, it may be to come back to the unit, but this is very important. What we don't want to see The basic principles, however, of all treatment are risk assessment, good planning of the dental treatment, allying it to the medical history, using an aseptic technique, minimal trauma, the use of local hemostatic agents as required. There are many on the market, and I'm sure many of the dental surgeons here will have their own favorite. We all have our own favorites, and it doesn't matter which one you use. The use of sutures is a little controversial. Some people will say use a resorbable suture. Some people will say use a braided non-absorbable. Others will say a non-braided non-absorbable. I routinely use a resorbable suture, but I will leave that up to each individual clinician. The thing that we don't like to see is this post-extraction bleeding, and this will need additional treatment. It must again be discussed with the Haemophilia Treatment Center. Almost certainly some form of cover is required before the area is re-explored. Local application of some form of topical bleeding product to stop the bleeding, and sutures. Local anesthesia is the last thing that we're going to look at, which is where is it safe? We've all heard the stories about patients being given dental injections and having problems with breathing. A lot of this work comes from the 1960s. We now know that a safe dental injection can be given in the sites of a buccal infiltration, an intraligamentary injection, an intrapapillary injection. The more dangerous ones are the inferior alveolar nerve block, because we're going through all the muscle to get to the nerve. We are concerned about a lingual infiltration because of the huge amount of blood vessels in that area. And those of us that use a posterior superior nerve block, again, we're going through muscle, and there is a danger of tearing the muscles. The lingual infiltration tends only to be used when we're doing an extraction where cover is required anyway. The use of the inferior alveolar nerve block can be avoided by the use of a buccal infiltration of articaine, a 4% solution of articaine and adrenaline. If this is used as a buccal injection around the lower molar teeth, then you can get the same level of anesthetic for a restoration as you would do with an inferior dental nerve block. The reason we are concerned is that this patient did receive an inferior dental nerve block without cover, and this is the sequel. In conclusion, providing patients with profound bleeding tendencies are managed with appropriate precautions in specialist units or in conjunction with the specialist units, they encounter few problems following minor oral surgery. This applies to all forms of dental treatment. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Brewer. Our second speaker today will be Ms. Karen Ridley.
Thank you, Dr. Lockhart. Oopsie. Okay. When I think about dental care for patients with bleeding disorders, it's the same as my goal for all of my patients, and that is for them to have a healthy smile. And a healthy smile can be an indicator of overall physical and emotional health. Women and girls with bleeding disorders who experience significant menstrual bleeding, they have paleness in their skin, eyes, and lips. We observe these as a clue to the patient's oral health. One way to look at dental health is to consider what I call the four keys of oral health: assessment, personal care, preventive strategies, and professional care. Assessment refers to my findings during my oral examination. Personal care includes daily oral hygiene and good nutrition. Primary preventive strategies include brushing and flossing, supplemental oral care. And professional oral care is that piece provided by the dentist, the dental hygienist. In addition, professional oral care requires that the dental team and the treatment center work together for a successful result. While these are the keys to good oral health for everyone, they are particularly important for women and girls with bleeding disorders. Let's talk about assessment. The first point I want to stress is that bleeding disorders do not cause dental disease. All dental disease is caused by plaque, a sticky bacterial film that forms on teeth and is fed by carbohydrate-rich diet and poor oral hygiene. Bacteria in plaque are gram-positive, gram-negative, aerobic, and anaerobic bacteria. Over 300 types of bacteria live in the oral cavity and can become incorporated into dental plaque. Plaque is not always visible to the naked eye. However, when stained with harmless red dye as seen above, plaque can be seen. Gingival tissue inflamed by bacterial plaque will bleed during brushing and flossing. In addition, this tissue may bleed excessively during dental treatment. This bleeding is not caused by von Willebrand's disease, but by plaque, and it is important to stress this to the patient. During certain times of life, such as puberty and pregnancy, the gingival tissue may be less resistant to plaque, and there may be increased tendency to bleed, even when oral hygiene is pretty good. Good oral hygiene plays a major role in reducing or eliminating gingival bleeding. I can't advance. Can we advance the slide, please? Thank you. In addition to assessing oral hygiene, the gingiva can provide clues to anemia. Women and girls who experience heavy menses may be anemic. Children who have mobile primary teeth that resist exfoliation may have what appears to be minor bleeding around the tooth. This very small amount of bleeding in children over a long period of time could actually leave the child anemic. Look at the color of the gingival tissue on these two slides. Notice that one is a healthy coral pink while the other is pale. These patients require a CBC, an assessment of the cause of bleeding. When a primary retained tooth is the cause, extraction is the best treatment. Hyposalivation, or xerostomia, can be another assessment finding. Hyposalivation refers to decreased saliva production. Xerostomia is the sensation of having a dry mouth. And it's important to remember that xerostomia is subjective and may not have a physiologic basis. There are many different causes of hyposalivation. The three most common causes of hyposalivation are medications, anxiety or depression, and dehydration. Some common medications that cause dry mouth are treatment for high blood pressure, anxiety and depression, allergy, antivirals, and medication for hyperactive bladder and ADD. These drugs will cause hyposalivation in children and aging adults, resulting in a high caries risk, halitosis, and the inability to wear dentures. These patients need teaching to stimulate salivary production, high-impact fluoride supplements, and dietary counseling, as well as hydrating agents. When it's all said and done, water is the best hydrating agent for hyposalivation. Somebody advance the slide, please. Thank you. Some findings in the mouth can be direct causes of mouth bleeds, particularly tongue bleeds. These include broken restorations, as on the upper left, broken teeth, distorted and broken partial dentures, and orthodontic wires. For children, removal of impinging orthodontic wires should be a priority. But all of these provide a sharp edge which can easily result in tongue trauma and bleeding. Patients need to have these corrected as soon as possible. Obviously, the best way to avoid this type of problem is by having routine professional dental care. The sharp edge of a broken tooth, however, can sometimes be modified by the patient with a small emery board. This is an emergency quick fix and not a long-term solution. Personal oral care is the patient's responsibility. Over the years, I've had so many patients tell me that their dentist told them not to floss because of their bleeding disorder, or they just don't floss because it makes their gums bleed. Patients always relate difficulty with their mouth, any kind of problems that they have, to their bleeding disorder. Every patient with a bleeding disorder needs to brush thoroughly a minimum of twice a day and use dental floss every day. That's the same as we would recommend for any other patient. Gingival bleeding should not be treated with Amicar, Stymate, or Factor. Gingival bleeding should be treated with increased oral hygiene, including daily flossing. Patients will find that with good oral care, bleeding will resolve relatively quickly. Selecting oral care devices can be challenging, even for me. Here are some simple guidelines. Toothbrushes should be soft and have rounded bristles. The toothbrush should be just big enough to cover two teeth at a time. Toothpaste should have fluoride. Dental floss can be waxed or unwaxed, flavored or unflavored. Beyond that, patients should discuss adjuncts such as special toothpaste or floss or additional oral cleaning devices with their dentist or hygienist. Power toothbrush is very effective, and many patients achieve better oral hygiene with a power brush. Point to remember, healthy gingival tissue does not bleed when brushed. If a patient has gingival bleeding, they should be evaluated by their dentist, but not discontinuing toothbrushing. Adult patients with continual bleeding, puffy gum tissue, and halitosis with gingival tissue that does not respond to oral hygiene should be referred to a periodontist for further evaluation. Treating with clotting agents will not cure the problem. Oral care is like anything we do in life. We need a routine. Toothbrushing should occur at least twice daily. Thorough brushing requires at least 2 minutes. Flossing should be done once daily, either at the same time as brushing or at a separate time. Establishing a routine and sticking with it will ensure better oral health. Fluoride is an important part of preventing dental disease. Fluoride should be part of every patient's oral care. In February of 2014, the American Dental Association changed their guidelines on fluoride. The ADA no longer recommends the use of non-fluoride toothpaste, sometimes called training gel, for children. Early childhood caries is rampant, and the ADA has decided that a small amount of fluorosis is better than caries. All children and adults should use fluoride toothpaste. The picture on the left shows toothpaste equal to a grain of rice for babies and toddlers. Older children should use an amount equal to the size of a pea. Well water should be tested for fluoride content, and when the result is less than 0.7 parts per million, fluoride supplements can be considered. Supplemental fluoride, such as over-the-counter fluoride rinses, can be used for children over the age of 6 and adults. High-intensity fluoride paste may be prescribed for teens and adults with a high caries risk. Professional application of fluoride in the form of varnish or gel should be available to both adults and children and should be applied up to 3 times a year depending on the patient's caries risk. In addition to fluoride, sealant should be considered and placed as soon as possible after teeth have fully erupted. Another preventive strategy is diet. Earlier we talked about plaque and said plaque is fed by carbohydrates. Healthy eating includes fruits, vegetables, and non-sticky foods, cookies, crackers, fruit roll-ups, candy, and other carbohydrate-rich sticky foods contribute to caries. In the patient with a bleeding disorder, caries are an expensive side effect of poor eating. During clinic visits, the dietitian and I work together to get a clear assessment of diet and make a recommendation. Interestingly enough, the story we get from patients is often very different, so it's important that the same questions be asked by more than one treatment member, staff member. May I advance the slide, please? The picture on the left shows a sad case of nursing bottle carry resulting from putting a baby to bed with a bottle. On the right side, however, is an equally disturbing picture, a bottle of soda pop chasing teeth. Be it a baby or a toddler sipping on a baby bottle or a sippy cup or a juice box, or teens or adults drinking soda or coffee loaded with sugary creamers all day, the result will be serious dental caries. For patients with bleeding disorders, there are increased risks and costs associated with extensive dental treatment. No patient enjoys a long clinic visit. Parents of little ones bring treats to make the time easier. But most often what I see are soda and baby bottles with juice, Kool-Aid, and other sweet liquids. I've done a lot of dental exams looking through cookies and granola bars. I encourage staff to work healthy diet into the clinic visit. Make water available as needed. The toddler in this picture will need to be treated in the OR. How much easier, less expensive, and safer it would have been to have avoided bedtime bottles and constant use of the sippy cup. In Michigan, our patients do not receive their dental care at the treatment center. We have an extensive network of community dentists who treat our patients and follow our guidelines, providing wonderful care for our patients. One of the most important parts of good patient dental care is communication with the dentist. I provide some guidance for the patient on how to approach a new dentist and what information they should have ready, such as a clinic business card. Once a patient has selected a dentist and had an initial visit, we can contact the patient and provide some basic guidelines for treating them. Appropriate educational materials can be sent. The treatment center then establishes a relationship with this dentist. One thing we have recently considered is putting our letter to the dentist on the back of the wonderful new flyer about women and girls that we have. Whatever you do, don't assume that a dentist has knowledge of von Willebrand's disease or any bleeding disorders. They receive basic information in dental school, but not enough to make them feel competent or confident in treating them. But they are wonderful learners. We rarely have dentists, even general or specialty, refuse to treat one of our patients. And while some cases require a lot of planning, we rarely have complications following dental treatment. One of the biggest problems in providing professional dental care to patients with bleeding disorders is the lack of agreement from one treatment center to another on treatment protocols. The centers I work with have been very progressive in treatment management, and this has worked very well for us. Patients with bleeding disorders, including women and girls with von Willebrand's disease, can have routine dental care without concern. Normally, patients do not need clotting agents for dental exams, radiographs, or impressions. For patients with a healthy mouth, clotting agents are rarely needed for teeth cleaning. Local anesthesia can be managed with amicar, stymate, or with more severe von Willebrand's disease with the use of a clotting factor. If patients report bleeding longer than 10 minutes after dental prophylaxis, or stop-start bleeding over a longer period of time, we have found that a single dose of amicar before or after the procedure is usually very effective. Unfortunately, not every patient will have a healthy mouth. Those who do not have healthy gingival tissue will need additional management. Ideally, the first step is changing the oral care pattern so the teeth are clean and inflammation is reduced. When dental treatment has deteriorated to the point of periodontal disease, the dentist and the treatment center work together on appropriate management for the patient, which could include scaling and root planing and periodontal surgery. The treatment center and the dentist develop a treatment plan with appropriate bleeding management. Treatment is done in the dental office, and we rarely have complications. The issue of antibiotic premedication prior to dental care when a joint has been replaced has been controversial for years. In December of 2012, the following appeared in the ADA Journal. The American Academy of Orthopedic Surgeons and the American Dental Association found that there is insufficient evidence to recommend the routine use of antibiotics for patients with orthopedic implants to prevent infections prior to having dental procedures, because there is no direct evidence that routine dental procedures cause prosthetic joint infections. However, many orthopedic surgeons still advise antibiotic prophylaxis prior to dental prophylaxis and oral surgery. When in doubt, the patient and or the dentist should get written recommendations from the orthopedic surgeon. While there may be some confusion about antibiotic prophylaxis following joint replacement, there is no confusion about prophylaxis for central venous access devices. MASAC recommendation 115C provides specific guidelines related to dentistry. Many children and adults with bleeding disorders have central venous devices, and these patients need to receive standard antibiotic prophylaxis before dental treatment. Exfoliation rarely causes bleeding, and when it does, it is more likely to be in children with severe hemophilia. A small gauze pad can be placed over the tooth site, and the child can bite on this. On the rare occasion that some nuisance bleeding occurs, place a small gauze pad moistened with Amicar over the site and have the child bite firmly. Bleeding with exfoliation most often occurs when a child or a parent attempt to remove the loose tooth too soon. Roots of exfoliating primary teeth are very sharp. And while we love kindergarten teachers, they love to put special little remembrances of children losing their primary teeth. So every child in the class wants to lose a tooth. I always stress to the parent and the payer and the child that the tooth has to be left in place until it essentially falls out on its own. Occasionally, an eruption cyst, as seen on the slide on the right, may develop. Eruption cysts are benign cysts that appear on the mucosa of a tooth shortly before its eruption. They may disappear by themselves, but if they hurt, bleed, or become infected, they may require surgical treatment to expose the tooth and drain the contents. Sometimes teeth develop a sort of a blue-gray color around the gum tissue. This is called an eruption hematoma and is due to the gums becoming thin in front of the erupting tooth and some minor trauma causing a bruise in that area. Often, it doesn't take much trauma to do this, just normal eating or biting on a toy. It does not hurt, and just like a bruise, will tend to go away on its own once the new tooth erupts. Treatment is rarely needed, and neither eruption cysts nor eruption hematomas are caused by von Willebrand's disease. They occur in children without bleeding disorders as well. It's a good idea to have the child's dentist look at it to rule out anything else if there is concern. This is probably a good time to talk about mouth bleeds in general. Most mouth bleeds in patients with von Willebrand's disease can be managed with Amicar or Amicar and stymate together. Some bleeds will need clotting factor. When in doubt or when bleeding, first aid has not solved the problem within 2 hours, parents should contact the treatment center for guidance. Some other first aid kinds of things that can be used are a moist tea bag, which doesn't usually go over too well with children, or just plain pressure with cold. Avoid sucking on pacifiers or drinking from straws at this time. And minor bleeds will generally clear up on their own. But when in doubt or when it continues to bleed, patients should call the treatment center for guidance. Most orthodontic treatment today is done with the use of brackets that are bonded to the tooth surface or removable devices. However, bands that go around the teeth are often placed on posterior teeth. Our treatment center recommends clotting agents for banding. For most patients with von Willebrand's, Amicar and Stymate and Amicar are sufficient. Oral hygiene during orthodontic treatment can be difficult, so supplemental fluoride, such as an over-the-counter rinse, is often recommended. Brackets and bands can be covered with a special cover to avoid tissue trauma. Sharp areas should be covered with wax to avoid the to protect the lip and the tongue. Children and or parents should be taught to do a simple finger sweep each morning and night to identify and cover sharp areas. Every adult with braces and child with braces, especially those with von Willebrand's, should have a mouth guard and wear it during all athletic activity. Orthodontic emergencies do occur. An irritating tie wire can be covered with wax or tucked under the arch using a blunt object such as a pencil eraser. A broken arch wire or one that is irritating the gum or cheek tissue requires replacement or adjustment to avoid tissue laceration and bleeding. Some emergencies can be avoided by doing a daily finger sweep and identifying those wandering wires. Orthodontists usually provide a good do and don't list, which should be followed carefully. All of the procedures on this slide can be offered to patients with bleeding disorders, as Dr. Brewer said. But planning is the key. Implants, endodontics, and periodontal treatment are all in-office dental procedures. The treatment centers I work with rarely hospitalize patients for oral surgery. When planning, ask the following questions. Is the patient compliant? Is the patient on home care? Does the patient live relatively near the treatment center hospital? If the answer to all of these is yes, then outpatient surgery can be considered. Other factors that have to be considered are a history of past oral surgery, the complexity of the planned surgery, the developmental status of the patient, and medical issues that might require hospital management. Orthognathic surgery would always require hospitalization. Following surgery, patients need appropriate pain management and plenty of ice to limit swelling. We recommend no smoking for 2 weeks or more prior to surgery, a mechanically soft diet for 4 or 5 days following surgery, no vigorous rinsing, avoidance of straws, and of course a strict regimen of clotting agents as prescribed. Patients also need to be given adequate teaching so they know when to call the treatment center. Maybe the most important consideration when planning oral surgery is the day of the week. We like oral surgery scheduled at the beginning of the week and never on Friday if it can be avoided. Dental care for patients with bleeding disorders is more common sense than complicated. These patients should benefit from the full realm of available dental services. My expectations for our patients is good oral hygiene and regular professional dental care. Unfortunately, that does not always happen, and when problems arise, then we have to develop a safe and well-coordinated dental treatment plan. And I'd like to thank two of our patients and two of my students for assisting with a couple of the slides in this presentation. I'd like to turn the program over to Dr. Lockhart.
Thank you very much, Ms. Ridley. And I'd like to thank both Dr. Brewer and Ms. Ridley for their excellent presentations and what they've shared with us today. At this time, we'll proceed with the question and answer part of our program. As a reminder, participants can submit questions via the chat box in your GoToWebinar control panel. Questions will be answered in the order they are received. And I will actually take the liberty of starting off the question and answer session and apologize to everyone for the fire alarm going on outside my office door. I hope no one can hear that too loudly. So a question for both Dr. Brewer and Ms. Ridley. I am curious about how you would approach and advise non-dental practitioners for their approach to the history and physical as it applies to dental health. What do you think is important for them to be aware about and routinely incorporate in to either their history with patients or their physical exam with women and girls with blood disorders?
Well, I think the first thing is that many dentists don't actually ask specifically about bleeding disorders. I know the American forms are much more comprehensive than the UK ones, but that is often the first problem, is actually identifying the patients correctly. And once you've done that, by contacting the hemophilia center and talking to the patient about how they manage it, what activities they can do, we can then get an idea as to how severe their condition is. Karen may know more about the history taking in America, though.
Well, no, I think that you've responded very well to that. I think most of the time what we have are health professionals that don't have a very strong background in coagulation disorders. It's very much like what I said about dental students not getting enough information about bleeding disorders to make them confident and competent. I think the same thing happens in medical school. And if part of that is because there's so much material to teach. So the general, the resident, the intern doing a pre-surgical assessment on a patient needs to have information about who to contact. So his contact with the primary hematology per coagulation provider so that he has more understanding of what's going on with the patient as well.
Excellent, excellent. All right. Well, thank you for that. We have received a one question, and this is again addressed to both Dr. Brewer and Ms. Ridley. Are there any available care plans for hematologists and dentists to use in the care of patients with bleeding disorders who have or may have oral surgery? Any care plans that can carefully monitor post-surgical issues or bleeding complications through your organizations? Are any plans like that available?
The publication which was done in the British Dental Journal does discuss oral surgery at length and talks about the various treatments that are required. With oral surgery, the important thing is actually not monitoring afterwards, it's the planning before, as Karen said. And it is to discuss, for the oral surgeon to discuss with the hemophilia treatment doctors the severity of the condition, how many teeth are coming out, how difficult do you expect the extractions or the work to be, and that will allow the hemophilia treatment center to decide on appropriate treatment for that patient, decide whether or not the patient can be treated as a day case or as an outpatient, whether they need to come in if it's more significant, again using the same guidance that Karen has mentioned. Following treatment, intraoperatively, we aim to get hemostasis. Now, we can use various topical measures, and there are various products like oxidized cellulose, which can be used in sockets following an extraction, along with sutures. This will give hemostasis, and it's really the monitoring of that afterwards that then follows. But if the planning beforehand is done well, we rarely have problems.
I couldn't agree with Andrew more. The monographs from the World Federation and the article from the British Dental Journal are excellent resources for anyone, for any oral surgeon or general dentist planning care. I think the biggest problem that we come across is when we get the call the day before or right then, the patient's there and we want to take a tooth out. We cannot do that planning on the spot like that. Planning has to be done in advance. So going through all the things that Dr. Brewer mentioned, knowing how involved it's going to be, you know, what all anticipated problems there are and so forth, and then working through that with the hemophilia treatment center staff should provide excellent results. And then I like to do a follow-up. So a lot of times if I'm concerned about a patient, I will call the patient a couple of days after the surgery, or I just might call the treatment center since my office isn't in the treatment center. I may call the treatment center and ask, how did so-and-so do? How did this surgery go? And I think that provides good continuity of care and everything should go well.
Thank you for that. We've received another question. And this is certainly what's been emphasized in both of your presentations today, is the importance in recognizing that dental care and bleeding disorders should be approached, particularly preventive care, as it would be in a general population. What's good dental health for the general population is the same as bleeding disorders. In considering women and girls with bleeding disorders, and Ms. Ridley, I believe you touched on this, in particular identifying pregnancy as a state where plaque buildup might change. Are there any considerations do you advise your patients on regarding their dental care that may be particular for women and girls? And if so, when would you start rolling this into your care for them?
Well, you know, if you look at the literature, studies show that somewhere between 25 and 91% of women who are pregnant have some form of what's referred to as pregnancy gingivitis. The better the oral hygiene, the lower it's going to be. And, you know, so often with your mild von Willebrand's patients, you see them in clinic once a year. So we may not see them during that whole time of pregnancy if it doesn't fall into their, you know, their actual clinic visit time. So for most patients, just continually stressing that good oral hygiene is necessary every single day, create the habit, and making sure that they're getting regular dental care. I can honestly say I've never had a pregnant patient with von Willebrand's disease have any kind of unusual bleeding. We saw the one patient in our new flyer who she's pregnant, and one of our patients, and I just have never had this issue. I don't know if Dr. Brewer has or not.
I've not really seen it as an issue. In Glasgow, we have a slightly different setup in that the hematology department or the hemophilia unit actually have a separate clinic in the maternity unit to look after these patients. So they are flagged up to us early.
Well, that's good to know. Thank you for that. Another question that has come up, and Ms. Ridley and Dr. Brewer, I know we had been talking about this before the webinar started, the question of tranexamic acid versus Amicar. Certainly in Europe, tranexamic acid is the antifibrinolytic of choice in many settings, not just dental, whereas in the United States, Amicar has been used more frequently. Can either of you speak to what you consider are significant differences between these therapies?
Well, I'm going to defer to Dr. Brewer on this one.
I don't think there's a huge amount of difference. There are some anecdotal comments which says that Amicar is slightly less potent than tranexamic acid. However, I've really only had experience with tranexamic acid. And although Amicar is available in Europe, it is very rarely used. I know that now tranexamic acid has been accepted by the FDA, and in developing the new treatment guidelines for the World Federation of Hemophilia, the American hematologists were very interested in trying to bring it into the States. One area where you may not be able to use Amicar as we'd use tranexamic acid is for the mouthwash, where with tranexamic acid we definitely can dissolve 2 tablets in 20 mils of water and use that as a mouthwash rather than using proprietary ones. I don't think that the Amicar works quite as well in that situation, and I've not seen any research to support that.
Well, thank you for that. Ms. Ridley, am wondering, in particular, you had mentioned some some issues with mouth guards in teenage girls and as they start to get involved with sports. And I was curious as well about some of the over-the-counter dental whitening treatments, whitening strips, whitening trays, if that has any significant impact on gingival or dental health, and certainly Dr. Brewer too, any impact that should be mindful, that these patients should be mindful of. Are they safe to use? Do you discourage them in bleeding disorders?
Oh, no, not at all. They're perfectly safe to be used. Maybe one of the negative side effects of bleaching agents is increased tooth sensitivity. So it's oftentimes recommended that during the same period of time that you're using a bleaching agent, that you use a fluoride rinse to try to help with some of the tooth sensitivity. But bleaching trays and the whitening strips and the paint-on bleaches, none of those are detrimental or have any negative side effects that I've ever encountered with patients with bleeding disorders.
I must agree with that. I've never seen any contraindications to using it. What I do find, though, is that the girls that use these products tend to look after their teeth well, so they get less problems with bleeding.
Yeah,
that's a great point. I have one last question, but while I'm asking this, I want to encourage our attendees, if anyone has any other questions, to please submit them. I know that there's been an increased level of ornamentation in some younger members of society with lip piercings and tongue piercings. Anything that you would take into, again, thinking about women and girls with bleeding disorders, anything you advise during this time, either while they're having this placed, discouraging them perhaps, or any changes in their dental care that they need to consider while having those?
Well, as far as discouraging them, that's first on my list. I highly recommend discouraging them from doing those kinds of piercings. However, piercings like the lip, the lower lip, and piercings of the tongue can often actually cause damage to the teeth adjacent to them. And that is something that needs to be pointed out to these young people. I am very strong at discouraging them to take them out. And oftentimes, when I see a patient in clinic that has one, as I'm leaving the room, I will say, "And you did promise me that when I see you the next time that won't be there, didn't you?" And it's amazing that they aren't there. Now, I have to say, sometimes I notice that they've been there. They just took them out for the day. So, but there can be some other serious problems associated with that. And I think I'll let Dr. Brewer comment on that, because that's sort of very much in his field.
Yeah, I mean, the biggest problem with piercings, apart from the one of the bleeding at the time, is that many of these piercings get infected, and we've had several patients, not necessarily patients with bleeding disorders, who have had quite severely infected tongues or lips with the piercing. My advice is that the patients shouldn't get them, and I think that the risks of the problems outweigh the benefits to the patient. Again, we've seen many problems with damaged teeth from the piercings. So I think discourage wherever possible.
Well, sounds like we have consensus on that issue. At this time, this concludes our question and answer period. You'll be able to review this webinar for your reference or share today's proceedings with your colleagues. Come back to it as reference for yourself by logging into MyFWGBD on fwgbd.org and accessing this webinar under the My Past Webinars section. We thank you all for your attendance and participation today, and we look forward to your return for future Foundation webinars. Thank you.